Hi, I'm Karen McKee, and today I'm going to cover some common beginner mistakes in writing a scientific paper. As a reviewer of manuscripts submitted to journals, I see such mistakes over and over. Also, some of these mistakes I made early in my science career. Here are five mistakes that I often see in papers, usually written by students, but that are easy to avoid. Slapdash abstract. Inexperienced authors often fail to write a strong abstract, instead leaving it to the last minute and dashing off a mediocre summary composed of sentences extracted from the narrative. In the worst cases, the abstract does not accurately reflect what was found in the study, or includes sweeping generalizations that sound good but are not supported by the data. Successful authors put a substantial effort into crafting their abstracts and know to write a unique, standalone summary that accurately describes why they conducted the study, how they conducted it, what was found, and why the work is important. In fact, the abstract will be the most read section of your paper. Take the time to write an abstract that will make a journal editor sit up and take notice, and that makes readers want to download your paper. Inordinately long introduction. In writing the introduction of a scientific paper, some novices go overboard in describing the historical setting for their papers. They try to cover the entire history of science back to Archimedes. Yes, you should put your work into the context of what has been previously reported, but you must be judicious about it. The length of the introduction should match the size and complexity of your study. A 5-page introduction is too much for a simple study based on a single short-term experiment. In most cases, a few paragraphs should suffice to orient the reader. Remember, you are no longer writing for your teachers to show how much you know. You are writing for a different audience, one that wants you to tell them something they don't already know. Sketchy methods. Beginning writers often fail to provide enough detail in the methods section. Someone reading your paper should be able to repeat your study using your description of study sites, subjects, experimental design, analyses, and statistics. Were field sites selected randomly or haphazardly? If a lab study, where were experimental subjects obtained and how were they handled prior to study? What experimental design was used? Were experimental treatments clearly and thoroughly described? How many replicates were there per treatment or other experimental grouping? Were there proper controls? What instruments were used, including manufacturer and model information? How often were measurements conducted? What statistical tests were run? Such details are necessary for other researchers seeking to repeat your work. But don't go to the other extreme and write too much. Standard methods require only a brief description and a citation. Lengthy descriptions of study sites, for example, can be given in online supplemental material. Statistical mumbo jumbo. In describing their results, some novices inadvertently hide their findings behind statistical jargon. This mistake occurs because the authors are too focused on the statistical tests which have helped guide them through their data. They then describe their results in statistical language instead of just saying how the experiment turned out. For example, they may write that a two-way ANOVA showed a significant interaction between species and salinity effects on plant biomass. This sentence fails to explain how salinity affected the two species. Instead, describe what happened in everyday language. Salinity reduced the biomass of species A more than that of species B. See Table 2 for ANOVA results. In this version, the reader is told how the two species responded to salinity treatment, and statistical details supporting this interpretation are given in a table. When writing your results, put yourself into your reader's shoes and tell them what you found. Discussion deja vu. A common mistake made by beginners is writing a discussion that mostly just repeats the results section with little or no interpretation. They restate the findings along with a few literature citations sprinkled here and there. What is expected in a discussion is an in-depth interpretation of the findings of a study that is backed up by a reasoned argument and relevant citations. The discussion will compare the results of your study with those reported by other investigators and offer explanations for any differences. There will be some repetition of the results, but only to orient the reader as to what is being discussed. For example, the finding that salinity reduced the biomass of plants agrees with previous work, see review by Smith et al., but additionally showed that species A was more affected by salinity than species B. Other points of discussion include limitations of the study, implications of the work, practical applications, and areas for future research. Well, those are five common mistakes made by beginners. Now that you know what they are, these mistakes are easily avoided. Links to videos with additional information about how to write an abstract, introduction, and discussion are given in the description below. Thanks for watching, and please like my video if you found it helpful.